So I'll be talking about how we can use Docker and Chef together to set up a complete CI/CD pipeline. But before I do that, I'm just curious to know how many of y'all are developers here? Really? Again, how many are from the ops background? Okay, so very few. And so others are, those who are neither ops and developers. Okay. Okay. So y'all are from management side? Okay. Engineering. Okay. Yeah. And how many of y'all have worked with, have some knowledge about Docker or worked with Docker? Okay. And Chef? Okay. Aware of Chef. Okay. So, since I see there aren't many who know Docker or Chef well, would you like me to explain a little bit about what is Docker, what is Chef, where they are used, so I can start from there? That's good, right? So I have primarily been a developer for several years. Till about 3 years ago, I was doing development for Chef. So I've been writing some Chef plugins, or I did a lot of contributions to the Chef knife plugins, knife WinRM. So while doing development for me, the domain for me was DevOps. And that's where the entire DevOps field seemed very interesting. And I gradually shifted my focus from doing pure development to being a real DevOps is what, whatever. So I've seen DevOps gradually evolve from writing some scripts or what the ops. So from ops perspective, even I do not have a lot of knowledge, or I might not be a very expert sysadmin. But since I was doing a lot of development for Chef, I was exposed to many use cases where Chef was being used for the kind of problems that people faced in the delivery pipeline. So eventually I started providing DevOps consultation. Right now I'm working with a company called Whitehouse Technologies in Pune. There we provide DevOps as a service. So we provide DevOps consultation. So I head that vertical in Whitehouse Technologies. So we believe that right now the DevOps space, right from the definition of what is DevOps to how you can do it right for your particular business case. So there is a big gap between how you can do it versus the a lot of tools that are available. So Docker and Chef, I would say that they are some of the tools that are available in the DevOps space. But how to use them, where to use them, and there are a lot of other tools like Jenkins, you must have heard things like CI, CD, continuous testing, and so many things, but what makes sense for your particular business case? So we try to help, consult, and try to provide some solutions about how you can do DevOps consultation. So I've, in that process, I've also worked a lot on Docker, and we are actually authorized Docker consultants also, and we are also authorized Chef partners, consulting partners. So basically, technology, innovation, and the thirst to keep learning are what drive me. And I feel since this DevOps space and things that are happening in this field are pretty dynamic and a lot of new things are happening, so I feel that I'm at the right place. I love to travel, read, write, and I have two kids back home. This is a rough agenda that we'll cover. So I'll just talk about what is Chef and how it got evolved, where it was used, followed by containers, then a little bit about Docker, how and why the need for, is there a need, and how we can actually use Docker and Chef together. I'll try to provide some examples about how you can do it. There is something called as, those who know Chef, there is something called as cookbooks. And then there are those Docker cookbooks which are written where you can actually integrate Docker and Chef together. So I'll give you an idea about that. Okay, so long time ago, like several years ago, about 10 years ago, if you can, how many of you are, y'all here are, have more than 10 years experience? So quite a few. So about 10 years ago, if you imagine the way a product was being written and being delivered versus the need for that the entire delivery pipeline has really you know, it has there's a need of continuous delivery, 10 deployments per day, and what all you've been hearing since morning. So rapid development, fast, accelerated deployments, and there are a lot of these buzzwords and keywords that we are hearing. So there is a big history. So 10 years ago, when people from systems admin were told to deploy something, so what the method that was followed is, in one of the, I think there was this wall, there is a this wall of confusion, of there is a partition between the developers. They write their code and then they hand it over to a build engineer. The build engineer will sit at his desktop and get that code from somewhere. He will build it. And this build process itself used to be one night's job, and then the next morning, it used to be passed on to another team who used to take that build. So if it was a Java code, it would have been a WAR file. They would take it, they would go and put it in the production mesh servers. So of course, then it's not that simple. When you are touching anything in production, there has to be certain norms followed. And then consider a case that a bad code has been pushed into production and you want to roll it back. What those system admins used to do is, if they had a Linux machine where they're deploying something, what they used to do is, there was something called as golden images. So they used to take a snapshot of the entire server, and that snapshot used to run in gigabytes of one image, used to take gigabytes of memory. And for every releases, for every changes, they used to maintain huge such data. During that time also, I mean, the storage devices also, if the server, the physical server went down or there was a problem, and if you wanted to copy that backup from one machine to the other, used to also pose a problem. Apart from this, there were a lot of other issues. When you're talking about a server, there are a lot of things that come into place, like which port should be opened, what are the security policies that should be applied. So a whole, what you would call as a whole system administration side, used to be, a lot of things used to be manual, and when things are manual, it slows down. And there, it's also prone to a lot of bugs and errors. So this system administration, or something that is more maturely called as configuration management, was the problem of that time, where which chef is trying or had tried to tackle at that time. So basically, Chef was written by Adam Jacob. He was doing a consulting for, he had written Chef for himself internally for his company, to provide, it aided providing better consultation service for the entire delivery pipeline during that time. And that's where he met Jesse Robbins. He showed this set of code to him, and then all of these, Barry, Nathan, and Joshua, five of them together, they founded Chef. And in sometime around 2008, Chef was founded. If you see, it was the first release of Chef was available in 2009. So Chef has a very long history. So it's been around in the market for a very long time. Chef was initially called, the name of the company was called OpsCode, and Chef was the product code, product name. I think 2 years ago, they renamed OpsCode to Chef. So now you just know Chef. Initially, it was called as OpsCode Chef. Someone out here, do you know what is Marionette? Those who know Chef out here? Like, do you know the history around what is that Marionette? Okay, initially, right in the beginning, Adam Jacob was thinking of calling Chef as Marionette, but eventually it was very difficult to write. So it was very difficult to type, like on the CLI, if you have to type something like Marionette, it's a bigger word. And then eventually he replaced it with Chef, and then the entire, you know, components of Chef were called as recipes, cookbooks, or even knife plugins. So that's how. So initially they were thinking of, it was actually, even before OpsCode, it was called as Marionette. It's written in Ruby and Erlang. And okay, what is these Facebook, Nordstrom, and Disney GE? Any guesses? Yeah, so they are the biggest clients of Chef, yeah, users. And they are amongst the top 500 companies, Fortune 500 companies. Okay, so Chef initially was solving the configuration management problem. And so the objective here is like, if a system admin has to manage, say 50 servers, then he will have to log into SSH to each server. He'll have to set up certain ports, configurations, ensure that your application consider there's a DB server, so there are certain different settings that have to be done as opposed to a web server. So all of these, smart system admins had started writing shell scripts, but still managing all of that was getting complex. Chef came with a lot of tools or some processes where you can actually do this better. But eventually, it was not just for the on-prem or something, it was also, it offers a lot of cloud management. So you can provision virtual machines in cloud using Chef. And there are, so anything around the infrastructure is what gradually Chef started offering. Right now, Chef is, last year they announced Chef Delivery as the end-to-end product, where it's a licensed product now, whereas Chef is completely open source. So Chef Delivery is something that they are completely concentrating right now. However, one of the biggest things of what a Chef is driving is the Chef community. Chef is completely open source, and Chef has a huge community. So typically, if I'm a DevOps consultant and I tell somebody, okay, use Chef, it's good. They find it good, they start using it. Tomorrow, if they find a problem, whom do they talk to? Because it's open source. So what I believe is the biggest drivers of Chef is the huge community. You just put a post that I am facing a problem. How many of y'all are clueless about what is Docker or what are containers? Anybody has? Okay, a little less. So containers are forms of virtualizer. It's a virtual machine, though not it's not a virtual machine, but it's a virtual box or a container actually, which is running on top of on an OS. Okay, I'll get to that in the next few slides, what it is. But if you look at container era, it too has a long history. So right from 2000, there was Jails, which was released for free BSD. Then later, vServer for Linux. Then there was an evolution of C groups, which was providing better controlled security groups on the container. Because during that time, security or portability was still an issue. Then the LXC containers came into place, which started making it containers as such more useful. And in 2013, Docker was founded, which made use of this LXC containers, but it made it a lot more useful. Docker has been written so useful, it's written so wonderfully that in June 2014, Docker 1.0, the first version was released. Today it's at 1.10 with a lot of features in it. Then come to this. Docker has seen a tremendous growth in the last 2 to 3 years. In fact, this particular presentation, baking Docker using Chef, I had presented 1 year ago at the Chef Conference Santa Clara in US. And when I was invited to present the same conference here today, in this 1 year itself, Docker, the entire ecosystem has changed so much that it is not possible to present exactly. Take whatever was presented last year, there is hardly anything that holds relevance today. So there was a lot of changes that I had to make it more relevant to fit in today. So in 1 year, so last year, exactly 1 year ago, the state was, is Docker really that good that it can be run in production? And if Docker is good, can Chef work together with it? And if yes, how? So it was more like a research or more like a R&D kind of a project during that time. But now we see lots of companies using Docker in production. And not just that, Docker is not just used for DevOps, it's also used extensively by the developers to write better code, to test better code, to do their setups. So there are a lot of applications that Docker sees. So while considering whether you should go in for, I mean, why Docker grew up, and there were a lot of other configuration management tools, not just Chef, but Puppet, which were catering to the entire infrastructure as a service, infrastructure as a code area space. And then suddenly with Docker, people started evaluating, do you need both? So these are some of the things that, points that come into picture. All these configuration management tools like Chef has a huge learning curve. To make Chef useful, there is a lot of knowledge that you need to have so that you can actually try it out. Whereas Docker was supposed to be very simple. You just take it, it's very simple, you just get started with it. You don't need a lot of systems knowledge, or you don't need a lot of other underlying fundamentals. You just run a few commands and you just have one machine ready on your desktop or anywhere, and you can just play around with it. So there was also, with Docker, Docker is also open source, Chef is also, however, there is no huge investment needed at the early stage. So consider if it's a startup, or if it's a big company who's considering some changes in their infrastructure. The thing to consider is there is a lot of money required to change or to even start something new. So there, initially, typically you start with doing small chunks, maybe 10 servers, 5 servers. And then at that time, Docker plays a very good, because there is the learning curve is slow, smaller. But with Chef, once the number of servers starts growing, that's where Chef, even today, it still has an upper edge. So in fact, it was last week or sometime, there is something called as Docker Swarm, which caters to how you can manage many, like Docker orchestration, how you can manage many Docker containers. So last week, somebody did an R&D and they figured out, okay, they can start 1 million Docker containers, and it is much better than something called as Google Kubernetes with instead of Docker Swarm. So this is something which is still being experimented, but Chef is still proven there. So that, so the question comes, if now Docker is being considered in huge numbers typically in production, huge products which are having huge number of servers, that's where the question is, that still unanswered question, how now I have 100 containers, how do I manage them? So basically Docker is a Linux container, it's open source. It can create lightweight, self-sufficient containers from any application. And the benefits are speed. So if you have to start a virtual machine or a Docker container is up in in less than a second. It's portable, so Docker can run on any underlying OS. So there's, in fact, now it even runs on Windows. Till last year, there was Docker did not run on Windows. And the density. So density, by density, I mean if on your laptop, has anybody tried starting a virtual machine using VirtualBox or VMware? So typically one or two or max three machines you can start. After that, your laptop will stop working. Whereas on one machine, Docker, you can run multiple, lot more instances of Docker on one hardware. Or Docker can actually run even on a virtual machine. So on a underlying machine, you can run more number of Docker containers than the number of virtual machines. So the density is higher. So I made a statement that, just to visualize, what is Docker? Docker, I said that it's a virtual machine. It's actually not. So the difference between the Docker and a virtual machine is the need for that hypervisor and the guest OS. The guest OS typically takes some GBs of memory, which is not needed in Docker. Docker basically makes use of the underlying kernel to start a container which has the complete space. It gives you a complete independent space where you can start your, you can run your applications in an isolated space, and that's all you need. For it, it makes use of, okay, and Docker needs a Docker engine. That's just what is needed. So of course, you need something which will run on top of it. So on The only requirement is your underlying machine should have Docker engine installed on it, and then you can run Docker. Yes. Okay. So consider your server here. This server or the host OS is right now Linux. Okay. Till today there was this Docker. There was a Docker engine written by Docker, which we had to install and set it up on Linux. Then, on top of that, this yellow thing, that's a Docker container. That yellow thing. So on top of that, you run a container. Inside that container, there will be another OS. That OS can be Ubuntu, Linux. It cannot be Mac and Windows right now. That OS, container OS. Now, what support was not there is, if this was Windows, there was no Docker engine which was available, okay, initially. So now you can run containers on top of any OS, and you can run any variants of, you can run CentOS, Ubuntu, Linux, any kind of, so that's how it is portable. So underlying, if you're, so portability, it's not just even OS. Sometimes there is a requirement, I'm just saying, consider it's a Java application, or more relevant would be probably Ruby application, where the backward support is not there. So sometimes, once the ROR version increases from 1.5 to 1.6, so typically 1.6 version doesn't, it cannot, 1.5 version will not run on Ruby 1.6, that kind of a thing. I'm giving this example just to say that sometimes when you change even the OS upgrade, if you say upgrade an OS from some X version to Y and you try to run your application on it, it may not run on top of that. However, if you run your application inside a Docker which has OS at a particular version itself, you don't have to worry what your underlying machine's OS is. You can keep upgrading or change it from CentOS to Ubuntu to Linux or any versions. You still have your application which will run correctly the way it has to. Another example, maybe you are using probably Mac for your development, and maybe Red Hat Linux is being used in production. And as a developer, I want to test the code. Instead of creating a virtual machine, you can actually run your application inside that container, and it becomes a lot easier as a developer to test it. Any questions till now? Okay, so basically, how do you start, or how do you define, or how do you create a Docker container? So this is basically a Docker file that you see here. If you see this Docker file, okay, if you see the Docker file over here, is basically just some Linux commands, or some commands that you want to run, which you specify using some basic, like if you look at that from Ubuntu 14.04, so basically it takes an image, a predefined image, and then it says that I want to install some packages on my machine, and then copy some kind of configuration to it from my local to the Docker. This is how you have defined that image. So basically what you're doing is your configuration, or the machine that is going to run on, or the container that is going to run, you basically codify it. You tell what is going to go inside it. So it's a set of bash commands. And so if this is called a Docker file, all that you have to do to build an image is Docker build hello scala, and it will build that image for you. So here, one thing I'd like to mention is there is a predefined image, some base images which are available on Docker Hub by Docker, and on top of that you start making changes. So when you say Ubuntu, it is like an OS that is going to run on your container, and then on top of that you need some kind of things, like you want Java or you want some other Node.js or whatever setups, then you'll have to do install Java JDK 1 or JRE 1.7 or something like this, all of these things you'll have to just set them up here. You can create an image and then you can distribute that image to whoever you want for, from developer's perspective. From DevOps people perspective, if they have to define that this is how my production web server is going to look like, all of this is in here. And if there are any changes, this Docker image is few MBs of takes few MBs of space, or you can recreate it because you have this Docker file. Scala was a language here. Yes, this is reference to a Scala language. Yes. So initially, so Docker initially was being initial first thing that I had heard about Docker was mainly Docker was used for testing purposes widely, and it seemed like the best application for Docker would be for testing, because in a testing environment, typically you end up polluting the entire environment, and then if you want to restart, you don't know what to do other than just format your machine or disk, or how do you go back to this. And typically regressive in the regression testing, and when there are lots of testing things being done, lots of tests being run, that's where this was Docker was being used. But then gradually when people started thinking about microservices and using Docker in production, they thought it is actually good to have your monolithic application break down into small chunks, put them into a Docker container, and then run them as separate services, run them as separate containers. Then CAS is container as a service. So this is what, so before that I'll talk about PaaS. PaaS is, there are a lot of tools like some, if there's this something like Travis CI, or there are a lot of hosted applications which make underlying use of Docker to provide some services. For example, there is a CI server which, so there is a CI server, it's a hosted SaaS application, and then it provides you machines on which you can run your builds. So example, if I want to do testing, if I want to continuously build my application on different versions of Java on different machines, then I tell Travis CI, and then Travis CI internally calls, spawns Docker images, and then it does some processing and provides. So this is some kind of PaaS offerings. CAS is container as a service, which Docker has started calling and said like they are providing the entire Docker ecosystem. Initially it was just one Docker container starts, but then there were a lot of other problems. How do I manage them? And so now they are providing container as a service. So if you want to, whatever your business case, whatever your use case is to use Docker, there is an entire ecosystem with a solution that is available. You run a container, get services from it. Yeah. So I mentioned that long time. So before I started, there was something like a thing about golden images and system administrators taking image snapshots. So they used to maintain those snapshots. Whereas Docker is also based on images. However, the way those images are created, there's something called as layers of images. And there are a lot of things because of which it makes it simple, simple as in lightweight, as well as fast. Configuration management was creating a lot of golden images. So this point is like you're controlling the environment with a system image, or it's a runtime image, or it's a Docker image. So these things have to be considered. There is a trade-off between flexibility and manageability. So if you have the entire server snapshot with you, you are sure that if you just bring it up back, it will be exactly the way it was running before. However, if you have done the same thing using configuration management, that is Chef, you've written huge lots of code, Chef code, which is going to create your server. If your server just one day just crashes, dies down, you can just run certain Chef cookbooks, recipes, or whatever Chef code that you have written, it will recreate the same thing on the top. There is a trade-off between what? Flexibility and manageability. In this case, it is a lot more flexible and it is more manageable using Chef. So configuration management is the bane of DevOps. Basically, there was an evolution from writing small shell scripts to a more mature way of doing configuration management using Chef. There is a concept of immutable infrastructure. It's the thing that infrastructure should not change. I mean, it doesn't change. That's where the images and snapshots comes into picture. So basically, Chef and Docker, if you have to compare by what they are actually tackling two completely different problems. Chef is basically, Chef, when it came, it replaced normal human tasks or better writing of shell scripts. Instead of shell scripts, let's do it more sophisticated way. It's like saying, I mean, just an example here. There is for this a conference itself, there's this conf engine that Naresh Jain has written. So there is this conf engine. The same thing, so what we have done is we've written some code around it. Consider that conf engine is not there. How would we all have registered or submitted proposals or seen the things is, there's still a way to go about doing it. It just makes it cumbersome. Writing code in a more organized manner just helps you do the same thing much faster. So same thing Chef was trying to tackle. However, what Docker is trying to do is trying to attack the same problem in a different way, in such a way that it seems more efficient and easy. And I hope I made this point clear. I think it was a little confusing. Okay. So, yeah, I can provide a demo here. I'm planning to. So, to give you an idea, what is being done here is there is some code, a Node.js code, Node. Which just prints hello world on it's an app server. It just prints hello world on the screen. If you make some changes to that code, a Jenkins build would be triggered. Jenkins is a CI server, so you just make change to it. It'll trigger. It'll create a Docker image from your application, and it will save that image in Docker Hub, and then it'll deploy it to an AWS instance. So I'll just go through that. So basically, there is some code over there, and for So basically, some companies might be still doing it. So it's not that everybody has changed. There are some companies which are using Chef. So if something like this happens, they run Chef. So basically, what Chef does is it writes some code such that it configures your server the way you want it. And that code, it writes a code as in we write Chef code. So and then it will configure the server the way it is. So if you want to recreate your server, you'll have to just run your Chef recipes, cookbooks. You'll basically run your Chef code. Okay, so in this, so that is one way. The other way is we don't use Chef at all. Okay, the other way of doing the same thing is what you do is whatever your server configuration is, that server is actually going to be the container. So your application is going to run inside the server. And that container configuration is done, an example was given where there is a Docker file. So if I can show, I'll show you that Docker file as an example here. So there is a Docker file in which you specify some bash scripts where you set up your server. In this case, the server is not the underlying server, it's the container, is what you would call the server. The underlying host machine, how would you start? That also needs to, the requirement was it should have Docker engine on it. Apart from that, it can run anything, any container on it, once done. So, okay, it, In the story, whenever there is a new build, a new Docker image is created. Right. So there is typically, okay, so I'll tell you. So there is a Docker image. I know. Okay, so so there is a Docker image which is holding information of what is there. But unless you run that image, when you run that image, it's a container, runtime. So when we are going to build this, when you build your app, you can actually just do an example. So to make it more relevant, you can do MVN clean packet, MVN build something where you create a war file. So in this case, if there is a plugin, you can, or if, for example, npm install and npm run for Node.js. For if it is Scala, you'd run SBT build or whatever. So basically, it is going to create an executable, some output, some application, packaged application, something that is a package which is going to run, ideally your build thing. This application you can go, Chef can take it and run it on your server. That is step. That is option one. Case two or option two is you don't go in that thing. You completely rework your mind. Don't take that package and put it inside a Docker image itself. And when you have to run, you run the Docker container. So when the Docker container runs, it has your application running inside it with the latest build. When you have a new build coming in, you have a new image. Then you decide, okay, now it's a new image, let me run this. So you stop the existing running container, you start a new one. If you have to roll back, you just start the other one. So that is a simplest case. So this is what I was trying to. So this is what this second case is done, can be done without using Chef at all. So if you see, there is MVN clean package Docker build. It is creating a Docker image. Jenkins or anything, like from any other, you can just think, there is some tool which will push this image to your some repository. You have to save all these. Like, it's like saving different builds. You are saving different Docker images, which are having different builds. So, example, the default open source or the free thing that is available for public repos is Docker Hub. Or you can set up. There are, again, different ways you can do it. There are different Docker trusted registry. There are a lot of things available. Artifactory and a lot of stuff. But anyways, so once you have that image, a lot of builds ready, you want to deploy. How would you deploy it? Then you can use maybe that one way is most popular way people use Docker with Ansible. Has anybody used Ansible here or heard of? Okay, so Ansible is also used to just deploy. Once you have that image, take it and deploy it to Ansible. Other ways, you don't use anything. You have just some script, basic script which says what that script would do is basically get me the last Docker pool, get me the latest or some particular build that I want, stop the existing container, run this the one that I've taken. Just three lines that you have to run. And then it will start your new version automatically running that is there. I'll show you this, but maybe we get it. I'll show you the demo, but I think I can just rush through this and come back to the demo maybe. A few more points, maybe they'll get more. If you get more questions, the demo will probably clarify. Or so basically, problem with that pipeline that we showed is, in actuality, it's a very simple case. In actuality, it's not that simple case. Whatever, it's a for understanding, it was a very simple demo that I will give you here. But in actuality, your application typically has a lot of things. Example, your application server is there, then your web server is there, and a DB server is there. A very, again, simple case, but a more practical case. Now, when as a developer, you're running your application and a DB server, you tell your application, connect to my dev DB server. Okay. When you are running the same thing in production, you tell that application, now connect to my prod server. So there is some kind of, what do you say, information that you have to give to the application at runtime. So, and all of this together, but you're going to run a container. So how do you provide that information? So a lot of these small issues start coming up. They are big actually, big issues start coming up. So there are different things. There are different credentials, packages, softwares, database, ports, files, environment specific configurations, some custom steps. There are a lot of things. How would you embed all of that inside that image? Because if you have to just run that image, it has everything running the way you want. but there are some things that you want to make it configurable, the image. Then how would you do it? So that is still a challenge in some way right now. Then there is a concept of different environments. There is a dev environment, there is a pre-prod, there is a prod, and then do you take the same, like, for example, if he has pushed some, as a developer, he wrote some code and pushed it. It worked fantastically. Then the same image was given to QA. It worked very well. And then the same image was given to prod. It will work well. But do you use the same image or should we use different images here? What about the configurations? Images are same, but the configurations are different. This starts adding a lot of complexities. So typically, the same image would move and all. So again, here, so if you have to give a database password, for example, some username password has to be given. So how would you do that in Docker images? That's a problem right now. There's something called as Docker Compose, using which you can specify that use an environment file. So where do you put your credentials? Do you put them in environment? So this is the recommended way. However, that's not a nice way. If somebody just logs in and says, does env show me everything, you'll see all the passwords and everything that is there. So it may not be the right way. Chef has a solution for it right now. There is something called as data bags or whatever, where Chef ensures your passwords and all are secure, more secure. Docker is still working on that part. Okay, one thing which Docker, so as I mentioned, Docker is eventually progressing. It's growing. Evolving. Initially there was just a Docker. Now the entire Docker system around it, Docker ecosystem around it is growing. So with that, what is still not available is how do you provision the underlying host? Consider you have thousands of AWS instances on which there are thousands of containers running, but what if the underlying host itself dies? Who will start it? How will you start it? So Chef, you can actually make, there is something called as Docker machine, which is not used. It's supposed to be used only by developers. Since most of you all are developers, you can figure that you can use Docker machine. But it was not used in by system engineering production for deployments. That's where still Chef is recommended. So how do you do that is there are knife plugins. Example, knife EC2 server create and it will create a server for you. And now this will get a little more, maybe I'll just skim through these things. Unless anybody who wants to go in detail with this cookbook, I'll go through. Or maybe after the demo, I'll come back. But I'll just skim through right now. So this is basically a Docker cookbook. And this is the chef code that I was talking about. This is a glimpse of the chef code. Or this is called as recipes and cookbooks. This is the kind of code you write in Chef. This is DSL or Ruby DSL written in that form. And there are different, if you see Docker registry, is that where you say, that is the address, and you have to push my image to a repository called HelloScala. And then there are Docker credentials, email, password for connecting to my repository. And these are coming from something called as data, okay, there it is, data bags. And then the passwords and everything is encrypted. So this is the solution that Docker Chef has right now for credential management. Again, this is Chef code where it is building the Docker image. Can you just, I had mentioned, what was the other way of building a Docker image that we just discussed? Anybody remembers? How can you build a Docker image? How can you create a Docker image? Yeah, so CLI is one thing. Otherwise, there are some plugins that are available in Jenkins or your Maven plugins, which would create the image, Docker image for you. Chef can also create a Docker image for you. If you take something else, maybe Ansible also has some things that you can create. Finally, okay. So this is creating. This is the code to create Docker image. Docker image when it runs, you call it the container or running image. So this is something that, and then here if you want to, so this is where you provide something like, okay, port mapping and stuff like that. Any questions on this slide? Right. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So yeah. So that port mapping over there, it maps the container port with the host port, because if the Docker container is running, it is utilizing the host resources, including the network. There is a way to now, there is a Docker file that is used to create a Docker image, which, as an example, if you remember, there was something like install JVM or something like that, or get the latest code from somewhere, copy configurations, or whatever, some bash commands are there. Chef can generate that for you also. Now, this is very useful because it can generate depending on some templates. Like if you have to generate so Docker build commands, if basically, so there is a template you can, this is actually a template, and using this template you can create a Docker file on the fly. So that is also something that Chef provides. So basically a basic Docker flow on top of that, Chef provides a lot of, all of those, they are called as resources or providers in Chef. That simple pipeline that we saw, it's a little more mature, would look like this. So you build the application, you build a Docker image, but that Docker image is built using the cookbook, and then it is saved to the Docker hub using, again, the Chef cookbook itself. And then you can run different Docker, different cookbooks where it will do the same thing. It will fetch the latest or needed build version from Docker Hub, and then it will run it on your machine. All of this can be done using Chef. So using Chef is one way to do it. To this after the demo. This so in some of the examples there was some hello scala, but in similar lines there is a hello node.js. So here is a repository. All that it does is it prints hello node.js on the screen. This is what you see. This is my application that is running. Here Jenkins will be building. So if you see, there is all that I've changed is hello node.js. I have changed it to welcome to Agile India conference. I'm going to push this change. Anybody uses Git for development? So I just pushed some code change, and so this on the UI you can see that now you should actually see welcome to Agile India conference. Building So Jenkins triggers a build, and this is something that we like to see. What happens here is Jenkins is did a simple build, and now it is, if you look at what it is doing here, is it is building a Docker image. Okay, and step one, so I should be showing you the Docker file here. This is the Docker file. This is a CentOS image. I have installed Node on it. Then the local, when like it's basically copied the source code, and it's done an npm install. This is something that port mapping is something which I'll be showing here. It's saying expose this particular port because my application is going to run on 8080. And if you look at this, it's exactly the same thing from CentOS 6. So from CentOS 6. So, and if you see, it's in steps. So the image is being built in steps. Step one, take the CentOS image. Step two is zoom. Okay. That's fine, I guess. From CentOS, this is the Docker file that I have. If you see this step 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it should have 7 steps, exactly 7 steps. Okay, so first step, and then it starts building the image. If at all there is a problem in one of your Docker command, like if I have written some fault, some wrong step in here, it would fail at that particular step, and next time when you try to you fix that and you come back and you try to rebuild it, it would have images ready. Docker internally would have images ready and saved on your machine the first two steps, so it doesn't do those steps again. It's already there. It picks it up and it starts from step 4 then, in that case. And then I used there is a plugin in Jenkins from where I pushed it to the Docker registry. It's here. Okay, it's showing. It's not showing. Free private repository, others are paid. Okay, there is a failure. That's why I didn't push. Okay, I'm going to try to rebuild. So, in fact, how many of you know what is continuous integration? Yeah. So there is, and all of you all are developers, right? Yeah. Okay. So there is also something new thing that you would like, maybe you would like to explore, is people are thinking, trying to take continuous integration one step ahead. So why have one Jenkins, which would do continuous integration for all of you as one team? So one repo, one Jenkins. Instead of that, you provide Jenkins inside a Docker to every developer and ask him, you keep testing everything the way you want. So whatever this is doing, everything is provided to developer as a Docker container. When he thinks that, okay, let me just unit test, he'll just run two steps or three steps and then go have a cup of coffee, and it'll do continuous integration, some testing, automated testing, all of that would be ready for you already. And then you'll be able to debug also. You don't have to push to your repository, to the GitHub for this to start. And so what I mentioned here was this just got pushed here. Continuous integration, right now how it is typically done today is, consider we all are a part of this Hello node in GitHub. So we all are developing one particular project. Though it might be different modules, it's one particular repository. So So we all make changes, and whenever there is a change in that repository, something like Jenkins, a CI server, will fire the build. It will package your changes. It may or may not deploy. Let's talk about just continuous integration. And then it will run some unit tests. It might run a few more extra functional tests or whatever. It will run some automated tests. Now, as a developer, can we get that integration? Why should I wait? Why should I push all of that to GitHub for that CI thing to fire and run some testing and then I see the results? Why can't I do it on my local? So what we are trying to work on is we get this entire CI setup inside a container, Docker container, and we give it to every developer. And then tell him run these two or three steps after you are done. If you think you want to do unit testing or certain testing, you just run it. So this, all of this is still, it's not being used anywhere. It's all in the conceptualization phase, but that's something that you can think of or try to read about offline. Yeah, so there would be a thing about, okay, it may not. It might take just your local code. So you don't have to push to GitHub to do any kind of testing. So if you want to do a lot of testing, it will be done. So there is one way. Now, since our image is ready, we can directly deploy. Or this is one extra a command just for demo purpose. There is an if SSH command. It will go and SSH into your node, and it will run something called as a chef client. And it will, if you see, I'm going to do hello node.js. So it will run the hello node.js recipe, which I will show you what it is. It's a very simple recipe. And so, and it tells, this is the password and all what is required. Yes, that's it. So if you see, basically it just SSHs into your machine. It's a test node that it's going to SSH to. Name, colon. So Knife SSH is a chef plugin, and there I have told it that, so the thing that was missing before is I didn't tell which was the configuration file, that is the knife.rb. That's also failed. It actually, the deployment failed here. I'll tell you what that problem was, but to see, okay, we can just log into that machine and check what it is and fix it and get it up, but then that is like a workaround. This ideally should have passed here. There was some problem with the, so if, let's go through what happened here. So if you try to debug this, what we have done in this, we've told SSH to the node that is that you want to, and then run the chef client. When I say, oh, whatever it says, run this recipe. So chef client will, you tell chef client, please update my node with something. And this is the hello node.js, okay? And it starts running. If you see, it's trying to run the recipe called default from the cookbook, hello node.js. Here, there was a problem. So let's try to debug what happened. Okay, looks like the shell command failed. Yeah, actually, yeah. So if you, my recipe was a set of bash commands. All that it did was it. Oh my God, my password. Okay, it tried to log in. Okay, it tried to log in, and it tried to stop the existing running Docker container, and it couldn't stop it. And then it tried to run again, and that's why it failed, and that's why the port wasn't used. Okay, so this is the test node on which. Actually, there is a little bit of network problem. It's just, okay, it worked. So this is the container that is running in here. If you do docker logs, yeah, it was not able to stop this. So if you see what is happening inside it, it says that the application is running. So because that's the only log that I have printed from my application saying where it is running. Okay. I will stop this, docker stop container ID, and it just stops. You can ideally go and start do a docker run, but instead of doing that, I'm going to run it through the chef. I'm going to run it the chef way. Chef client dash o hello node.js. Still failed. If you look at the images, you'll see a lot of Docker images here. We have to run the Docker. Dash D is the daemon mode. I'm going to do the port mapping here. So this was it, like when it was running, if you see there was a port mapping done, and then instead of 8080 we had exposed port, but while running the container we told listen on 49160. I wanted to show you the cookbook and last thing probably. So this is how basically chef looks. So just what we did over here is, on this particular machine, we ran some Docker commands. And since this is a simple example, here I can show it. We did a Docker PS. It shows you what is running. If you do a Docker stop, container name, it will stop. Then we also did a Docker run. All of this was packaged together into a chef cookbook, which is. CD, hello. Basically, what we did is docker stop, pull. There was just, docker tag is one command where it's like a rename image with, and you, instead of saying latest, call it the current that is running. And then you run the docker command. So, and if you see, all of this is basically the simplest chef recipe that one can write. When you say it is bash, you tell it, it's basically it's a chef resource that it's running, and when you're running it here, when you're specifying it, typically what happens is here is there is a chef client which runs on the target node, and you tell that chef client what jobs needs to be done, and then you tell him, okay, now you have to deploy, now you have to update yourself, now you have to change something. You just give instructions to that node through chef. That's how you manage. And same thing, you can do control all of that, all of those Docker commands through this. You can tell it. And this is just one last point I'd like to touch here. So what we covered right now was very basic understanding of what is debug. How a chef would be ready to deal with this. However, in reality, there are a lot more things that are a problem. So the entire ecosystem or the points under question or other thing here is like, if you want to debug your applications that are running inside the container, consider that something happened to your application folder. The container will stop. And then you want to go inside and open the container and stop. How do you see what happened? How do you see those logs? How do you figure out what exactly happened? So that is still a little bit of an issue. Docker networking, this point was where we did that code mapping. Different codes were mapped. There are a lot more issues. Consider there are 2-3 different containers running on the same DB. And they are all identical. They are all applications that are running on the same DB. How would you do all of that? So this is, in a way, tackled in the latest version where we have introduced the Docker network. Still, some things are open. Notification is something where what is happening with your Docker thing, and whether it's a notification chat or phone or something, that is something which is available with Docker to do. Cluster management or orchestration is about cluster management is something. You want to run a group of servers, containers together. This is a pool of one and orchestration for both of these, right now, chef is directly not very useful to deal with cluster management and orchestration. This was a step that I gave Docker Swarm. That is something which has come out. There are a lot of other tools that are in this. The most popular one being Kubernetes, which has schedulers is something where you schedule to run containers. How many containers are loaded? So basically, this is something which is in the data. So you meant to say you run the slave nodes on different containers. Yes, that is possible. Yes. So that is right. So here you would have, so depending upon the load, you will start your slave nodes, or you'll have a static number of slave nodes.
So we have to find
x. So that is possible. So if yes.
I didn't get your question. In one container, I didn't understand.
In one container, can I
okay. So typically, one container will run only one OS. But if is it something like consider that is your question like this, right? If you want to check if your particular build works on 5 different OS or different versions, 3 different OS. Okay, consider. So that you can do it without any additional issues is in your build step itself, or where you create an author image itself, with just few lines of change, 2-3 lines maybe, of change, you specify which 3 OS versions you want to test your build. It will create 3 different containers and it images, and it will run 3 different containers. And then your build will, same build will be running in 3 different OS.
Any questions?
Thank you.